This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The 1924 Democratic National Convention, also called the Klanbake, held at the Madison Square Garden in New York City from June 24 to July 9, 1924, took a record 103 ballots to nominate a presidential candidate. It was the longest continuously running convention in United States political history. It was the first major party national convention that saw the name of a woman, Lena Springs, placed in nomination for the office of vice president. It was also known for the strong influence of the Ku Klux Klan. John W. Davis, initially an outsider, eventually won the presidential nomination as a compromise candidate following a virtual war of attrition between front runners William Gibbs McAdoo and Al Smith Davis and his vice presidential running mate, Charles W. Bryan of Nebraska, went on to be defeated by the Republican ticket of President Calvin Coolidge and Charles G. Dawes in the 1924 presidential election contents 1 site selection 2 the primaries 3 Ku Klux Klan 31 KKK platform plank 32 Impact 4 results. 41 President 411 First ballot 412 15th ballot 413 20th ballot 414 30th ballot 415 42nd ballot 416 61st ballot 417 70th ballot 418 77th ballot 419 87th ballot 4110 100th ballot 4111 103rd ballot 4112 Full balloting 5 vice presidential nominations 6 prayers 7 legacy 8 see also 9 references 10 further reading 11 external links site selection The selection of New York as the site for the 1924 convention was based in part on the recent success of the party in that state 2 years earlier. In 1922, 13 Republican congressmen had lost their seats to Democrats. New York had not been chosen for a convention since 1868. Wealthy New Yorkers, who had outbid other cities, declared their purpose to convince the rest of the country that the town was not the red light menace generally conceived by the sticks, though dry organizations opposed the choice of New York. It won McAdoo's grudging consent in the fall of 1923. Before the oil scandals made Smith a serious threat to him, McAdoo's own adopted state, California, had played host to the Democrats in 1920. The primary's main article, Democratic Party United States Presidential Primaries, 1924. McAdoo swept the primaries in the first real race in the history of the party, although most states chose delegates through machines and conventions, giving most of their projected votes to local or hometown candidates, referred to as favorite sons. Ku Klux Klan. The Ku Klux Klan was resurrected after the 1915 release of D.W. Griffith's very popular motion. Picture the birth of a nation after World War I. The popularity of the Klan surged due to connections of its public relations leadership to those who had promoted the successful Prohibition Amendment to the U.S. Constitution, becoming a political power throughout many regions of the United States, not just in the South. Its local political strength throughout the country gave it a major role in the 1924 Democratic Party National Convention DNC. However, its participation was unwelcome by many DNC delegates. The 20th century Ku Klux Klan was notoriously anti-Catholic and anti-Semitic. In addition to being anti-black, the Klan advocates opposed those supporting Catholics from the major cities of the Northeast and Midwest. The tension between pro- and anti-Klan delegates produced an intense and sometimes violent showdown between convention attendees from the states of Colorado and Missouri. Klan delegates opposed the nomination of New York Governor Al Smith because Smith was a Roman Catholic. Smith campaigned against William Gibbs McAdoo, who had the support of most Klan delegates. KKK platform plank. The second dispute of the convention revolved around an attempt by non-Klan delegates, led by Forney Johnston of Alabama, to condemn the organization for its violence in the Democratic Party's platform. Klan delegates defeated the platform plank in a series of floor debates. The final vote on condemning the Klan was 54,285 in favor, 54,615 against, so the plank was not included in the platform. To celebrate, tens of thousands of hooded Klansmen rallied in a field in New Jersey, across the river from New York City. This event, known subsequently as the Klanbake, was also attended by hundreds of Klan delegates to the convention, who burned crosses, urged violence and intimidation against African Americans and Catholics, and attacked effigies of Smith. Impact FDR nominating Al Smith at the 1924 Democratic National Convention. The notoriety of the Klanbake convention and the violence it produced cast cast a lasting shadow over the Democratic Party's prospects in the 1924 election and contributed to their defeat by incumbent Republican President Calvin Coolidge. Smith's name was placed into nomination by Franklin D. Roosevelt, in his first appearance at the Democratic National Convention since his paralytic illness. This signaled a political comeback for Roosevelt. He would be elected governor of New York 4 years later and president 8 years later. Results: President Governor James M. Cox of Ohio, FMR Treasury Secretary William Gibbs McAdoo of California, Governor Al Smith of New York, Ambassador John W. Davis of West Virginia, Governor Charles W. Bryan of Nebraska, Senator Oscar Underwood of Alabama, Secretary of Agriculture Edwin T. Meredith of Iowa, Senator Carter Glass of Virginia, DNC Chairman Homer S. Cummings of Connecticut. The first day of balloting, June 30, brought the predicted deadlock between the leading aspirants for the nomination, William G. McAdoo of California and Gov. Alfred E. Smith of New York, with the remainder divided mainly between local favorite sons. McAdoo was the leader from the outset, and both he and Smith made small gains in the day's 15 ballots, but the prevailing belief among the delegates was that the impasse could only be broken by the elimination of both McAdoo and Smith and the selection of one of the other contenders. Much interest centered about the candidacy of John W. Davis, who also increased his vote during the day from 31 to 61 with a peak of 645 votes on the 13th and 14th ballots. Most of the favorite son delegations refused to be stampeded to either of the leading candidates and were in no hurry to retire from the contest in the early balloting. Many delegations appeared to be jockeying for position, and some of the original votes were purely complimentary and seemed to conceal the real sentiments of the delegates. Louisiana, for example, which was bound by the unit rule, first complimented its neighbor Arkansas by casting its 20 votes for Sen. Joseph T. Robinson, then it switched to Sen. Carter Glass, and on another ballot Maryland Gov. Albert C. Ritchie got the 20, before the delegation finally settled on John W. Davis. There was some excitement on the 10th ballot, when Kansas abandoned Gov. Jonathan M. Davis and threw its votes to McAdoo. There was an instant uproar among McAdoo delegates and supporters, and a parade was started around the hall, the Kansas Standard leading, with those of all the other McAdoo states coming along behind, and pictures of McAdoo, Democracy's Hope, being lifted up. After 6 minutes the chairman's gavel brought order and the roll call resumed, and soon the other side had something to cheer, when New Jersey made its favorite son, Gov. George S. Silzer, walk the plank and threw its votes into the Smith column. This started another parade, the New York and New Jersey Standards leading those of the other Smith delegations around the hall while the band played Tramp, 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 the Boys Are Marching. First ballot Democratic National Convention presidential vote, first ballot candidate votes. Percentage: William G. McAdoo 4,315, 394%, Alfred E. Smith 241,220%, James M. Cox 59,54%, Pat Harrison 435,40%, Oscar W. Underwood 425,39%, George S. Silzer 38.35%, John W. Davis 31.28%, Samuel M. Ralston 30.27%, Woodbridge N. Ferris 30.27%, Carter Glass 25.23%, Albert C. Ritchie 225.21%, Joseph T. Robinson 21.19%, Jonathan M. Davis 20.18%, Charles W. Bryan 18.16%, Fred H. Brown 17.16%, William Sweet 12.11%, Willard Salisbury 7.06%, John Kendrick 6.05%, Houston Thompson 1.01%. 15th ballot Democratic National Convention presidential vote, 15th ballot candidate votes. Percentage: William G. McAdoo 479,436%, Alfred E. Smith 3,055,278%, John W. Davis 61,56%. James M. Cox 60.55%, Oscar W. Underwood 395.36%, Samuel M. Ralston 31.28%, Carter Glass 25.23%, Pat Harrison 205.19%, Joseph T. Robinson 205.19%, Albert C. Ritchie 175.16%, Jonathan M. Davis 11.10%, Charles W. Bryan 11.10%, Fred H. Brown 9.08%, Willard Salisbury 6.05%, Thomas J. Walsh 1.01%. Newton D. Baker 101% 20th ballot. McAdoo and Smith each evolved a strategy to build up his own total slowly. Smith's trick was to plant his extra votes for his opponent, so that McAdoo's strength might later appear to be waning. The Californian countered by holding back his full force, though he had been planning a strong early show, but by no sleight of hand could the convention have been swung around to either contestant, with the party split into two assertive parts. The rule requiring a two-thirds majority for nomination crippled the chances of both candidates by giving a veto each could, and did, use. McAdoo himself wanted to drop the two-thirds rule, but his Protestant supporters preferred to keep their veto over a Catholic candidate, and the South regarded the rule as a protection of its interests. At no point in the balloting did Smith receive more than a single vote from the South and scarcely more than 20 votes from the states west of the Mississippi. He never won more than 368 of the 729 votes needed for nomination, though even this performance was impressive for a Roman Catholic. McAdoo's strength fluctuated more widely, reaching its highest point of 528 on the 70th ballot, since both candidates occasionally received purely strategic aid, the nucleus of their support was probably even less. The remainder of the votes were divided among dark horses and favorite sons who had spun high hopes since the Doheny testimony. Understandably, they hesitated to withdraw their own candidacies as long as the convention was so clearly divided. Democratic National Convention presidential vote, 20th ballot candidate votes percentage. William G. McAdoo 432,395%, Alfred E. Smith 3,075 280%, John W. Davis 122,113%, Oscar W. Underwood 455.41%, Samuel M. Ralston 30.27%, Carter Glass 25.23%, Joseph T. Robinson 21.19%, Albert C. Ritchie 175.16%, others 975.86%. 30th ballot. As time passed, the maneuvers of the two factions took on the character of desperation. Daniel C. Roper even went to Franklin Roosevelt, reportedly to offer Smith second place on a McAdoo ticket for their part. The Tammany men tried to prolong the convention until the hotel bills were beyond the means of the delegates who had traveled to the convention. The Smith backers also attempted to stampede the delegates by packing the galleries with noisy rooters. Senator James Phelan of California, among others, complained of New York rowdyism. But the rudeness of Tammany, and particularly the booing accord to Bryan when he spoke to the convention, only steeled the resolution of the country delegates. McAdoo and Bryan both tried to reassemble the convention in another city, perhaps Washington, D.C. or St. Louis. Democratic National Convention presidential vote, 30th ballot candidate votes percentage. William G. McAdoo 4,155 377%, Alfred E. Smith 3,235 294%. John W. Davis 1265 115%, Oscar W. Underwood 395 36%, Samuel M. Ralston 33 30%, Carter Glass 24 22%, Joseph T. Robinson 23 21%, Albert C. Ritchie 175 16%. Others 955 99%. 42nd ballot Democratic National Convention presidential vote, 42nd ballot candidate votes percentage. William G. McAdoo 5,034 457%, Alfred E. Smith 3,186 289%, John W. Davis 67 60%, others 2090 194%. 61st ballot as a last resort, McAdoo supporters introduced a motion to eliminate one candidate on each ballot until only five remained, but Smith delegates and those supporting favorite sons managed to defeat the McAdoo strategy. Smith countered by suggesting that all delegates be released from their pledges, to which McAdoo agreed on condition that the two-thirds rule be eliminated, although Smith fully expected that loyalty would prevent the disaffection of Indiana and Illinois votes, both controlled by political bosses friendly to him. Indeed, Senator David Walsh of Massachusetts expressed the sentiment that moved Smith backers, "We must continue to do all that we can to nominate Smith. If it should develop that he cannot be nominated, then McAdoo cannot have it either." For his part, McAdoo would angrily quit the convention once he lost, but the 61st inconclusive round, when the convention set a record for length of balloting, was no time to admit defeat. Democratic National Convention presidential vote, 61st ballot candidate votes percentage. William G. McAdoo 4,695–426%, Alfred E. Smith 3,355–305%, John W. Davis 60–54%, others 233,215%. 70th ballot, the Honorable Samuel Moffat Ralston. It had seemed for a time that the nomination could go to Samuel Ralston, an Indiana senator and popular ex-governor advanced by the indefatigable boss Thomas Taggart. Ralston's candidacy might look for some support from Bryan, who had written, "Ralston is the most promising of the compromise candidates." Ralston was also a favorite of the Klan and a second choice of many McAdoo men. In 1922, he had launched an attack on parochial schools that the Klan saw as an endorsement of its own views, and he won several normally Republican counties dominated by the Klan. Commenting on the Klan issue, Ralston said that it would create a bad precedent to denounce any organization by name in the platform. Much of Ralston's support came from the South and West, states including Oklahoma, Missouri, and Nevada, with their strong Klan elements. McAdoo himself, according to Claude Bowers, said, "I like the old senator, like his simplicity, honesty, record," and it was reported that he told Smith supporters he would withdraw only in favor of Ralston as with John W. Davis. Ralston had few enemies, and his support from men as divergent as Bryan and Taggart cast him as a possible compromise candidate. He passed Davis, the almost consistent third choice of the convention, on the 52nd ballot, but Taggart then discouraged the boom for the time being because the McAdoo and Smith phalanx showed no signs of weakening on July 8. The 87th ballot showed a total for Ralston of 93 votes, chiefly from Indiana and Missouri. Before the day was over, the Ralston total had risen to almost 200, a larger tally than Davis had ever received. Most of these votes were drawn from McAdoo, to whom they later returned. Numerous sources indicate that Taggart was not exaggerating when he later said, "We would have nominated Senator Ralston if he had not withdrawn his name at the last minute. It was a near certainty as anything in politics could be. We had pledges of enough delegates that would shift to Ralston on a certain ballot to have nominated him." Ralston himself had wavered on whether to make the race, despite the doctor's stern recommendation not to run and the illness of his wife and son. The senator had told Taggart that he would be a candidate, albeit a reluctant one, but the 300-pound Ralston finally telegraphed his refusal to go on with it. 66 years old at the time of the convention, he would die the following year. Democratic National Convention presidential vote, 70th ballot candidate votes percentage: William G. McAdoo 5,285–480%, Alfred E. Smith 3,345–304%, John W. Davis 67.60%, others 170,156%. 77th ballot Democratic National Convention presidential vote, 77th ballot candidate votes percentage: William G. McAdoo 513,477%, Alfred E. Smith 367,333%, John W. Davis 765.69%. Others 134,121%. 87th ballot Democratic National Convention presidential vote, 87th ballot candidate votes percentage: Alfred E. Smith 3,615–328%, William G. McAdoo 3,335–303%, John W. Davis 665–60%, others 3,365–309%. 100th ballot Democratic National Convention presidential vote, 100th ballot candidate votes percentage: Alfred E. Smith 3,515–324%, John W. Davis 2,035–187%, William G. McAdoo 190,175%, Edwin T. Meredith 755.70%, Thomas J. Walsh 525–48%, Joseph T. Robinson 46–42%, Oscar W. Underwood 415–38%, Carter Glass 35–32%, Josephus Daniels 24–22%, Robert L. Owen 20.18%, Albert C. Ritchie 175–16%, James W. Girard 10–09%, David F. Houston 9–08%, Willard Salisbury 6–06%, Charles W. Bryan 2–02%, George L. Berry 1. 01% Newton D. Baker 101% 103rd ballot Governor Charles Wayland Bryan The nomination, stripped of all honor, finally was acclaimed to John W. Davis, a compromise candidate, on the 103rd ballot, after the withdrawal of Smith and McAdoo Davis had never been a genuine dark horse candidate, he had almost always been third in the balloting, and by the end of the 29th round he was the betting favorite of New York gamblers. There had been a Davis movement at the 1920 San Francisco Convention of considerable size. However, Charles Hamlin wrote in his diary, Davis frankly said that he was not seeking and that if nominated he would accept only as a matter of public duty. For vice president, the Democrats nominated the able Charles W. Bryan, governor of Nebraska, brother of William Jennings Bryan, and for many years editor of the Commoner Loquacious Beyond Endurance. Bryan attacked the gas companies of Nebraska and bravely tried such socialistic schemes as a municipal ice plant for Lincoln in 1922. He had won the governorship by promising to lower taxes. Bryan received little more than the necessary two-thirds vote, and no attempt was made to make the choice unanimous. Baos were sounding through the garden the incongruous teeming of the distinguished Wall Street lawyer and the radical from a prairie state provided not a balanced but a schizoid ticket, and because the selection of Bryan was reputed to be a sop to the radicals, many delegates unfamiliar with Davis's actual record came to identify the lawyer with a conservatism in excess even of that considerable amount he did indeed represent. Full balloting 1-20 presidential ballot 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th. 10th, 11th, 12th, 13th, 14th, 15th, 16th, 17th, 18th, 19th, 20th, J.W. Davis 3-1, 3-2, 3-4, 3-4, 3-4-5, 5-5-5. 55-57-63-57-5-59-60-645-641-63-64-66-845-122 McAdoo 4-315-431-437. 4-4-3-6-4-4-3-1-4-4-3-1-4-4-2-6-4-4-4-6-4-4-4-6-4-7-1-6-4-7-6-3-4-7-8-5-4-7-7-4-7-5-4-7-9-4-7-8-4-7-1-5-4-7-0-5-4-7-4-4-3-2 Smith
241-251-5555-260-261-261-5-275-278-2995-302-301-303-535-306-5-305-305-305-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-315-
859-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60-60 435 decillion 235 nonillion 235 octillion 205 septillion 205 sextillion 205 quintillion 205 quadrillion 205 trillion 205 billion 315 million 205,215. 205 205 205 0000 Underwood 425 42 42 415 415 425 425 48 455 439 billion 425 million 415,405 405 395 415 42 395 395 455 Silzer 38 30 28 28 28 28